It's a blessing to be able to share this information. I've spent my life attempting to bring in a richer context to spiritual teaching. I've worked with the Holy Spirit and Jesus, Ananda Maima, and Ramana Maharshi as a overall effort of encouragement to give a richer, clearer context to spiritual teaching. And so, without further ado, we will introduce one more clarification, looking even deeper than we have before. It's a very important one, very important one. And that is, namely, to say that what can never start doesn't need to be prevented from starting. Okay, what can never start doesn't need to be prevented from starting. And what is it that can never start? It is time that can never start. Existence is a imaginary simulation presented by mind at the request of spirit to prepare spirit for the quote-unquote start of time, which is really the start of spirit's annihilation. Spirit's annihilation and then rebirth, resurrection from this annihilation, so that spirit can be prime creator. This time, this death of spirit will never start. Time will never start. It will never take place. So all our preparation for it is just, it's aimless, meaningless activity. So we can see that, oh, we don't need to prepare for what will never start. Time will never start. But there's an additional layer to that, and that is to say, we don't need to spend our time preventing time from starting. And this is like, wow, this is the other side of the coin. Because so much, it seems like so much of our concern is, we've got to make sure that time doesn't start. We've got to make sure time doesn't start. We don't have to be concerned about that. What can never start doesn't need to be prevented from starting. So we can let go of it. We can let go of it. We don't need to be concerned. We don't need to be concerned. We don't need to have any focus at all on prepping for time, either to prep for it to start or to try to prevent it from starting. Both. No concern whatsoever. In other words, we can take our attention off of the world without any concern. I believe that it's the concern that we need to prevent it from starting that pulls us back. When we talk about getting glimpses of freedom, of no thingness, of realizing we don't need to define what we are and shifting our perception so we don't see thingness. What pulls us back is we say, oh, yeah, that's great, but I gotta prevent thingness from happening. I gotta prevent time from starting. I gotta make sure it doesn't start. So what can I do to make sure it doesn't start? And oh my gosh, we see we don't need to work on that at all. So this is like a new layer of liberation. It's a deeper liberation. We see this, oh my gosh. Not only do I not need to prep for the starting of time, I don't need to work on preventing the starting of time. And for me, this seems to be a greater depth of freedom and liberation to see this. Something that can easily slip through the cracks. We didn't even think about it. It just popped into my mind this morning. Oh my gosh, we don't need to try to, I don't need to try and prevent the start of time. So, we don't have to do anything at all. We don't have to prep for time. We don't have to stop time from starting. So, many have caught glimpses of dropping the attempt to define what we are, which is really an attempt to bring about our own demise, defining what we are. How can we define endlessness? But these glimpses don't last. And we're struggling, say, well, why? I just don't get it. Why doesn't it last? And I would submit that it is based largely on saying, okay, I know it's possible, but now I just have to prevent time from starting. I gotta prevent thingness from starting. You know, I gotta prevent it. No preventative steps need to be taken. How about that? How about contemplating that? Contemplate that today. No preventive steps need to be taken. What is impossible does not need to be prevented from happening. What can never happen does not need to be prevented from happening. This is great stuff here. I mean, I'm very happy to see this this morning. Because the mind tricks us. The mind, when we say, time will never start, we don't need to prepare for time to start. And the mind will say, oh, that's great, very great. And, okay, now you've reached the higher level, and now you can be the world savior, and you can prevent time from starting. Just think what a great world savior, a master, a spiritual master, you have. You can now work on preventing time from starting and save everybody that way. What a trap, isn't it? What a trap, the mind. The mind psychs us out again, because we asked it to. We don't need to prevent time from starting, because time, there's no such thing. That's like saying we got to prevent nothing from arising, or what can never arise, we need to prevent it from arising. I say, wait a minute, if something can never arise, if impermanence can never be true, why do we need to prevent it from being true? You see? It's like there's something inside saying, hey, wait a minute. This is like this is a trick that mind has been using on us, isn't it? Thank you, mind, for being such an obedient servant and using such a diabolical trick. Because that's exactly what we asked you to do. So, very obedient servant. If lies can never be true, do we need to prevent lies from being true? Do we need to say, we're protecting reality from lies, we're preventing them from being coming true, and therefore we're great spiritual warriors? Do we need to be spiritual warriors? Who needs to be a spiritual warrior? What are you warring against? You're warring against time, trying to. We're preventing time from starting? Preventing lies from being true? Becoming true? Are we preventing something from becoming something else? Where is the need for spiritual warriors? What's calling us into battle? To defeat what? So when taken to heart, this clarification, we may feel sort of like floating a little bit, like, whoa, I don't know. It's change. My perception is changing here. I don't need to do battle with anything. I don't need to go to battle. What needs to be defeated? What can never be? Is what can never be, does it need to be defeated? Does it need to be tied up? Suppressed, put in chains. So anytime one gets into a deeper level, there's always this slight disorientation, or it's sort of like, I'm not sure what to do next, which is fine. That's why inquiry has this cool down period, and it's like, wow, what do I do next? If I don't need to go to battle, if I don't need to defeat time, if I don't need to prevent time from starting, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? Probably share this information with others. Probably relax too. Relax. Relax the focus, the effort. See a new scenario. Now, in order to defeat something, one has to define a thing. So time has to be defined. If we want to prevent time from starting, we need to define time. How do we define time? By perceiving things, by perceiving boundaries. But this is where one thing stops, this is where another thing starts, etc. Boundaries, definitions, which is how we're using perception. So we don't need to, if we realize we don't need to stop what can never start, we don't need to define what it is we're trying to stop, do we? We don't need to define what it is that we're not trying to stop. We don't need to define. If we're not trying to stop something, why do we need to define it, what it is? Why do we need to search for it? Why do we need to see it? Why do we even need to be aware of it? If we're not trying to stop something, why do we need to be aware of it? Why do we need to perceive it? So, time can never start. There's no such thing as time. So we don't need to prevent it from starting. So why do we need to even see it, or define it, or imagine what it could be? Why do we need to even imagine what it could be, so we could work on a prep to try and stop it? So if we don't need to see it, cannot we use our perception in another way? Right now we're using our perception to imagine what time could be. First we've used our imagination, simulation, to imagine what time could be so we're ready for when it starts. And then mind says, oh, you see that? Okay. And now mind tells us, use your imagination to see what time is so that you can prevent it from starting. See, that's a trick. And that maintains our perception of thingness, of definition. This is how we're defining time. But if we don't need to prevent it from starting, why do we need to define time? Why do we need to imagine what it could be like? Why do we need to perceive thingness is the question. We don't need to. And so, internally, is like my mind is like, kind of just like, not sure what, you know, also saying, if I don't need to prevent something that can never take place, what can never take place does need prevented, then why do I need to simulate this to prevent it? Why do I need to see it at all? Why do I need to pay any attention or be aware or define it at all? Why do I need to define it? Why do I need to define nothing? Or what can never be, why do I need to define it? So that I can work on trying to prevent it. And if I don't need to define it, then that relates directly to my perception, what I perceive, what I'm perceiving. If you can link it up to that and realize our perception is for the purpose of defining what it is we want to work on, whether it's the beginning of time or preventing time from starting, our perception is literally what we use to enable us to imagine that we're working on this. But if we don't need to work on either of those scenarios, either the starting of time or preventing it from starting, what do we need to perceive then? What can our perception be? What can our perception be like at that point? And this is what we need to discover. This is what we need to look at. How can I, free of those ridiculous mandates, what is my perception then? Doesn't need definition, does it? Doesn't need to be seeing things, boundaries, defined boundaries. Of course, there's a play of light, of intensity. But is that really boundaries? Do we really need to see boundaries? Defined boundaries, actually. That is some kind of actual start and stop boundary. Or can we see, feel as if everything is one whole play of light with different intensities, varying, kaleidoscopic, changing and varying in different rates, but no actual boundaries, real boundaries at all? And wouldn't this be the perception of oneness, vision of oneness? And isn't perception really a mental phenomena? Sneeze. Okay. Isn't the perceiving of boundaries an arbitrary mental decision? Are there really boundaries? Are there actual boundaries of definition? Are we just superimposing that upon what would the world, etc.? Are they actually there? Are the boundaries actually there? Are they really, is it really the ivy? Is there a boundary where it's ivy and then it's not ivy? Or is it all just the play of energy, play of light? Is there an actual boundary? Or is it a mental overlay because we want to see it that way? Because it's useful to see it that way. So that we can see that we're preparing for time to start, or working to prevent time. The idea is that in time, there will be these boundaries, you see? So the question is, are the boundaries actually there? Is the definition actually there? Or are we just superimposing it to help us prepare for the beginning of time? And if they're not actually there, then how hard is it to remove what's not actually there? It's just a decision, isn't it? Nothing needs to be removed. There's nothing there. We have put definitions and labels upon everything. And of course, words are arbitrary because language, everyone uses different words, different syllables, different sounds, or just sounds for stuff. But is there an actual separation between anything? Is there any separation at all, actually? Here's the question. Or is the separation merely a superimposition, like a blueprint we're superimposing because we want it to be there? We're just pretending it's there. We're simulating as if it were there. But it's actually just being imagined. It's not really there at all. And if that's the case, do we need to keep it there? Keep simulating, keep imagining it's there? Is it difficult to get rid of if it's not there? If something is not there, how difficult is it to get rid of it? It's not difficult at all. What's difficult is to keep imagining that it's there. So the condition of my mind right now is like wow. And also, yeah. And there's some acceptance saying like, ha, I like this, I like this, I like this, I like this. Yeah, that's great. This sounds very true. Sort of a remembrance, like, aha, okay. And then also kind of a little bit of floatiness, like, wow. That all our definitions are something we are projecting. Exercise all this projection, all this imagined separation, all this imagined thingness, all this imagined definition. Now, of course, there's different densities of energy everywhere, but it's all one phenomena, actually. One dance. Without any actual boundaries. And yet, see, our perception that we have now is not showing this to us. We're not, because what we're seeing is we're superimposing the interpretation, how we want to interpret what we're seeing, as boundaries and definitions, hard definitions actually, which basically are saying there isn't a whole, there isn't one totality. Right? That's the purpose. Because the purpose again is to train spirit to die, and spirit is one totality, reality is one totality. So in order for it to die, it has to not be that. So it has to be separation, boundaries, definitions, fragments. All these fragments sitting here. There's the ivy, there's the wall, there's the tree, there's the shrubs, there's the ground, there's the concrete, there's this. Everything like little, you know, little models are placed together on a stage. But they're some kind of discrete, concrete, defined boundaries, definition here. But this is simply our own imagination. Imagination of mind telling us this. And of course our perception seems to be backing it up. But remember, mind is the one bringing about this perception. Perception is like neutral. It doesn't really tell us anything. It's the mind that is projecting all this and saying, this is what you're perceiving. But mind can just as well say, no, this is what you're perceiving. You're perceiving the oneness. But there is no definitional hard boundaries anywhere. That can be seen too. That can be seen as, you see one or the other, you can't see both. And this other perception, no hard boundaries definition, is a vision of oneness, spiritual vision. It's still perception. So again, do we need to prevent from starting what can never start? This is looping back now to the essence of it. Because this is what's been holding us back. What's been holding us back is our attempt to hold back the starting of time. That's what's been holding us back. What's been holding us back is our belief that we need to prevent time from starting and be spiritual heroes by doing this. And this is, again, mind's definition of what a spiritual hero is, what we need to do. We don't need to do anything. We don't need to hold back, prevent. We don't need to prevent from starting what can never start. There's absolutely nothing we need to do. Nothing we need to do about that. And so, therefore, we don't need to hold back our vision of oneness. Those two are two sides of one coin. If we don't need to hold back time from starting, neither do we need to hold back our perception of oneness. So we are making dramatic progress right now. Very dramatic progress. And so I'm pumping out these videos as soon as it comes up. I'm putting them up, putting them out. Because this is the time. Dramatic progress is being made. No question about it. Just in the nick of time, because the most disappointing thing I've ever seen, it came out this morning in the paper, it said the majority of people in the U.S. don't care at all about all the surveillance and the police state. They don't care. So, oh, it's fine, no worries. It's like, huh? It's like, what's more disappointing, the spying on everybody, or that people don't care and think it's fine? You know, they say, there's no worries. Nothing to see here. That's what's disappointing, amazing, huh? Truly shocking and amazing and dismaying, and yet we don't need to prevent time from starting. And therefore, we realize we can allow perception now to see the oneness. And allowing perception to see the oneness is preparing to step into timelessness. Truly, it's a preparation towards accepting reality as it is. And we still have another step to take. But prepping for timelessness is that step. And so getting this out, seeing that we don't need to prevent time from starting, frees us from this world. It frees us from this world, literally. Both figuratively and literally. This world is dedicated to simulation of time. Very dedicated to it. So we don't have to stay here. We don't have to. We can. We can stay here in a condition of vision. That's very possible. Of course we can. But also we don't necessarily have to stay here. Options open up. Because then the death-free realms don't intimidate us or scare us. Because there's no death. You don't feel like a definition of thingness, because everything is sharing the same attribute of permanence, of no death, of no harm, no sickness, disease, accident, nothing. And it's easy to drop your efforts to prevent time from starting. You can work directly on that. You know, so we do have other options other than this planet, this world, definitely do. So obviously this planet is accepting the 4D police state. Obviously, we knew it would. And now the cat's out of the bag. The real cat that's out of the bag is the public acceptance of it. It's not all the secret stuff that's going on. It's the public shrugging their shoulders and going back to their television sets. Say, nothing to see here, no worries. We got 1,000 channels. So, it's again, this June thing is a tremendous thing, what's going on. Tremendous thing, situation is going on. Parting of the destiny pass, absolutely. And we are certainly primed for that. So again, we don't need to prevent from starting what could never start. We don't need to do anything about it. We don't need to even be aware of it, or even think about it, or even imagine it, or even perceive it. We don't need to define it. What can never start doesn't need to be defined. What can never begin doesn't need to be defined. There's no need for any definition of it. There's no need for any awareness trying to turn that direction. Imagination, we don't just need to simulate it. We don't need to simulate the beginning of it. None of that. We don't have to have any attention on it at all. We can drop that attention. We can drop any efforts or simulations in that direction altogether. Okay. Let's cool down here just a moment. This is a little rushed, but that's the times we live in right now. Things are rushing along. We don't need to define what can never be. As if we could be heroes to prevent what can never be from being. There are no heroes in heaven. There are no heroes in heaven whatsoever. The kingdom, there's only one kingdom. And those all in the kingdom knows there are no heroes in that kingdom, because nothing needs to be prevented. There's nobody at the gates of heaven preventing the crashers from coming in, the barbarians from coming in, no. So we need to drop the heroism. We don't need to prevent time from starting. It can never start. It's the will of God that is why it can never start. Heaven is not threatened at all. There's no threats to reality. Reality is not threatened in the slightest bit. So we don't have to protect reality. We're not on some mission to protect. We're not in any position to stop anything. We're on a mission to realize we don't need to stop what can never start. We're on a mission to realize we don't need to stop what can never start. Very simple. All right, that's it.